Anonymous.
Cyber attacks.
A new kind of warfare.
Hackers and activists.
Security leaks.
Computer hackers.
Hackers.
Activists.
Anonymous has struck again with a warning. This is just the beginning.
Anonymous is a collective known for recent attacks on government and corporate websites.
The internet is a powerful new medium where just a handful of people in small groups, just by shifting data around in the right directions, can make big changes and big damage.
The more you said, the more frightening it was.
The Pentagon is now singling out Anonymous as an example of the serious new cyber threats facing the country.
The fundamental unit here is information warfare.
We're gaining back the freedoms that the forefathers assured us through technology, and we can't allow these freedoms to be taken away. I will put my body on the altar of liberty again and again and again.
Information is the weapon, and information properly understood and properly used in an honest way is more effective than anything else in the world.
If you've got your eye on Boeing, yeah, please go for it. I'd like to see those fuckers go down. Download the code, modify the code just a bit, bombard the Pentagon. You're either with us or you're against us.
You have 15 minutes available for this call.
Hello? Andrew? Are you there?
It's not scary to be going to prison?
No, I never was scared to be going to prison. There's all these cool people, and I'm learning all these cool things, and you know, I'm making lifelong future friends, and you know, it's future business partners, certainly. Embarrassing people. I enjoy it. It's viscerally fun.
He's an instigator.
The most lovable little pest on the internet.
His ability to make other people so angry is the talent that he has.
Almost 99% of the articles that come out for Weave, they all start with, he's a dick, he's an asshole.
Little Weave is going to troll the fuck out of Apple and AT&T.
How do I plan on keeping my cornbread safe in prison? I will stab a nigger that dares reach across my plate. I am the Bruce Lee of RegXP. I didn't get caught. I put my name on what I did.
I'm not here to play nice with AT&T, I'm here to comment and criticize. There was a URL on an AT&T web server with a number at the end. And if you had add one to this number, like you could have typed it in the iPad web browser over and over again, you would see the next iPad 3G user email address. Here's AT&T handing out a complete target list of their customers. It was morally required to come forward and sort of put them over the coals for this. It was like 114,000 email addresses.
And it's quite a list.
New York Times CEO Janet Robinson.
White House Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel.
Diane Sawyer.
Not to mention the U.S. Army and Congress.
It doesn't get much more high profile than Mayor Michael Bloomberg of New York City.
Mayor Bloomberg was like, this isn't a big deal. It's not like people can't find my email address.
I'm aggregating public data and using it to criticize people whose politics I dislike. The FBI is combing through people's emails, grossly violating their constitutional rights. I think I have moral superiority here.
Bow, bow, bow,
IRS and FBI are like both walking here, and they're looking at the computers and they're like, my God, these red dots, they're converging. They hit a button.
No black SUV.
There's been black SUVs outside like the past couple days, so.
All the red dots are in the same room right now.
There's gonna be even more later.
Magic fucking genie, you're actually in power, you're in charge.
The most drastic improvements that need to be made are in the education system. We need to give people the kind of classical Western education that they used to have. We need a curriculum that embraces, you know, like Keats and Byron.
It doesn't sound revolutionary.
It's absolutely revolutionary. We have people in power that have explicitly engineered our education system to make people dumb, obedient, and uncreative. Getting them out of fucking power and remaking it so people can be free-thinking, well-educated, sensible, non-reactionary people, this is a revolutionary thing, and it's probably going to require a whole lot of bloodshed.
Why has the FBI targeted you?
They have, by their own admission, been surveilling me since I was 15 years old. That was in the search warrant they used to kick in my door in 2010.
And why?
They wanted me to inform on hackers on the internet. You know, like they've tried to get me to do that many times.
There is a congruence between whistleblowing and hacktivism and hacktivists. The similarity is speaking truth to and of power, revealing the power structure, whether it's corporate, whether it's government, or both.
I was a senior executive at the National Security Agency, and I served there for about 6.5 years. I blew the whistle on the secret surveillance program called Stellar Wind, which were the foundational surveillance programs that ultimately Edward Snowden, 12 years later, is now disclosing through reporters and journalists. The government went ahead and prosecuted me under the Espionage Act. And I faced, it was a 10 felony count indictment, I faced 35 years in prison.
Hackers are important in the sense that they have the capacity to expose the secret or the inner workings of the state, which is why they are terrified of hackers and they are going after them with phenomenal vengeance.
We are looking at increased transparency.
Unprecedented transparency.
They want to avoid scrutiny. So our response, our best weapon, is to bring scrutiny to them.
CNN and all these other things, they're not going to spend a single hour doing actual investigation.
He called the former head of the NSA at home, like, on a weekly basis for a couple months, trying to get him to talk to him.
Barrett was speaking in that language of real adversarial journalism, that the purpose of journalism is not to please those in power, but to report the truth, even when it makes those in power uncomfortable or reflects poorly on them.
Years old, a cocky college dropout, a self-described anarchist, Brown proclaims he is policing wrongdoing.
He was brash, he was cocky, he was arrogant.
He's fucking full of himself. He's awfully narcissistic.
He held court, so to speak, from his bathtub.
Fucking around on Tiny Chat. Fuckers, but you can't take away our fuckers. We're growing up in middle of the digital ruckus. You can say fuckers, I am putting on the stoppers. We could be hackers, making it like Lakers. While we become workers, you become gophers. The modern day cop is beating on us for the papers.
The take of NBC Brass was Barrett was not a very appealing character. He was not somebody that they wanted to tout as in any way heroic or doing an admirable thing.
Barrett was somebody who was very open about his own struggles with substance abuse.
He was on a maintenance drug, like a methadone, like he was on Suboxone. At least he was trying to stay off hard drugs, you know, to be on at least a medicine.
Who are the members of Anonymous? Who are they?
They're everyone. I mean, you'd be amazed. There's obviously a lot of people who are hackers or just work in IT. They right. work for major corporations in some cases. There's journalists, writers of all kinds, people who work at gas stations.
What is Anonymous?
It's basically the power of an absolutely massive group of people coming together.
Anonymous are your brothers and sisters, your sons and daughters, your parents and your friends. Anonymous is you.
Somos anónimos. Somos legión.
ونحن نتسامح مع جرائمكم.
We were involved in Operation Tunisia, Operation Libya, Operation Algeria, and Operation Egypt.
Anonymous cannot and will not stand idly while people are being denied their basic rights and human liberties.
Understand that something is horribly wrong with this world.
The Tunisian government has made itself an enemy of Anonymous. The Egyptian government has revealed itself to be criminal
for the good of mankind and for our own enjoyment.
To end the corruption, we must expose it.
If you are working for a corrupt company, leak the data. If you are working for a corrupt government, leak the documents.
Think for yourself. Question authority.
Join us in this battle for freedom of information worldwide.
Remember, we are you. Anonymous is you. And you are Anonymous. You are fighting for yourself, the web, and for the next step in evolution.
It's a very interesting relationship Barrett has with Anonymous. Barrett's Anonymous. He's their spokesperson. Barrett's not Anonymous. He's not their spokesperson. Is Barrett really Anonymous because he doesn't hack and he doesn't really have computer skills? Well, does he have a Guy Fawkes mask?
He was fulfilling a very valuable and important function, which was to give Anonymous the legitimacy it needed. He was the person who was willing to go on record.
It's an open brand. Like, anyone can sort of label what they're doing Anonymous. If you're doing something that people don't approve of, then Anonymous will turn in on itself and sort of like eliminate that, you know, like whatever it is that doesn't kind of fit in with the truth-seeking, justice-seeking ideology.
Are you not worried that even an informal involvement with Anonymous is going to end up with you targeted, with you potentially going to jail for this?
I mean, in Texas, an indictment, it's like a Texas bar mitzvah. I got friends who've indicted, gone to prison. I mean, you know, it happens.
He was interacting with other hackers. A couple times he wanted to make the point that he was not a hacker, that he was of the community.
Anonymous members try to hack into people's personal accounts and attempt to post personal information. We haven't tried to hack into anybody's personal, like a military person's personal account. And if we did, we wouldn't fucking go around bragging about it beforehand. We would wait until we were done. This article is also poorly written, and I object to that.
He wasn't able to just kind of do anything cleanly without people giving him a hard time about it.
My actual title is Cobra Commander. So that's what needs to be acknowledged, I think, further. I also go by faggot now.
They use that non-pejorative fag.
Weird bars.
He's an ego fag and a moral fag and a leader fag and a, you know, just about everything, but a, you know, but a fag is, you know, leave it to the internet to have to repeat themselves.
What happened today is certainly illegal. Why are you willing to show your face?
I'm more useful as a name fag than I am just as another person with his name hidden.
Barrett being a named person was his own doing. He did not show up as Anonymous. He showed up as Barrett Brown.
There's a new world being born here. At least that's the perspective of the people in it. And I think Barrett really reflected that and gave voice to this emerging worldview. Whether it's valid or not is another question.
We are anonymous. We do not forgive and we do not forget.
I'm the de facto leader of a movement, screaming hack the planet back in 99. Activism in its prime.
Sabu spoke about things in terms of this being a movement for revolution, and everybody was his comrade or his brother.
He had kind of built himself up within Anonymous and had this reputation of doesn't give a fuck freedom fighter.
There's de facto leadership, de facto organizer. Someone had to have the idea and start bringing people in. So for a little while, they're going to listen to this guy. They're going to say, what are we doing here? Why are we doing it?
There are two types of hackers. There's a ghost hacker who constantly changes his identity so nobody knows who he is or even how to really get a hold of him. And then there are people with permanent fixed identities.
Subversion. Fuck the feds. Fuck the government's obsession with controlling the people, and fuck our lack of privacy.
Sabu had a permanent identity. He made it pretty clear what his philosophy, his politics were.
I find him to be incredibly annoying. He uses words like, what's up, niggy, and he's a very, like, to me, like, I'm annoyed by everything that he says. Like, I don't like his terms and the way he talks.
He was the king of the hacking world, doing it like a sir, in fact.
Friends around the globe, we are low security.
Oh, that's unexpected.
LulzSec came from Anonymous, and they enjoyed what each other did.
Laughing out loud at security, LulzSec.
Greetings from Anonymous. For the past decade, the government has tried to take control of our internet ocean.
The LulzSec boat was just sailing the infinite seas of hacking excellence, hacking the shit out of everybody.
Yeah, yo, that's right.
Fox, X-Factor, Sony Pictures, FBI Affiliate, CIA, PBS, Senate, Bethesda, Sun, News of the World, Arizona Police Department, AOL, AT&T, NATO, US Navy, your mother, who's next?
Topier, is everything alright? Are you dead?
Crossing the road, I'm not gonna
Are you okay? Remember you tweeted my fucking phone number, said 512-560-2262, here's the leader of the LulzSec, call him now, you put it on the fucking LulzSec Twitter.
Barrett Brown is the leader of LulzSec, give him a call now.
I got 200 calls.
I might have been a bit inebriated.
Hurry up! Get the sign. Do you have it? Oh my god, you did it. Oh my god. Oh my, you did it, man. I'm standing here watching it. You did it. It's working. It's totally working.
I was working in a cubicle. I'd be like, oh, what are those LulzSec guys doing today?
You know those God hates fags, morons that protest soldiers' funerals and stomp on American flags because they got a problem with gay people?
God hates fags. What part of that don't you understand, girl?
I don't fucking understand why God hates fags.
Because he can.
You can sometimes take over the websites themselves, put messages up as we did today with Westboro.
That's unexpected.
If you check downloads.westboro-baptist-church right now, you'll see a nice message from Anonymous.
The hacks got bigger and bigger and bigger. Pull up the screen and they're like, tango down, CIA.gov for the lulz. Like, oh shit.
What a hacktivist can do and does do all the time is embarrass the power elite in a way that, you know, boots on the ground can't. So you can go and sit in front of a building you can circle the Pentagon. That doesn't really embarrass anyone. If you hack the website of the CIA, you've embarrassed the power structure of the nation state. You've embarrassed the Pentagon. You've embarrassed the United States of America. You've embarrassed it by puncturing the illusion of their power.
You made us look bad. You taunted us. We don't take too kindly that. You embarrassed me. So when someone comes along, like a hacker, and exposes the dark underbelly of this beast, that beast, it's not just tickling the beast, they're gonna take some swipes at you.
One of the most notorious hacking groups of all time has had its head chopped off.
We turn to the government crackdown on a loose, large network of politically inspired hacktivists.
A 19-year-old who goes by the nickname Topiary was arrested in Scotland's Shetland Islands.
The FBI will pull in some 17, you know, 20-year-old kid and threaten them with 100 years in prison just to get them to, like, inform on people. There were at least three, you know, snitches involved in the takedown of LulzSec. This was a domino effect. People were taken into custody that folded on their comrades.
Want to speak to me? Want to join the fight? Go to Wall Street and protest.
On September 17th, 2011, Sabu comes back on Twitter from his, like, month-long absence, and he's like, "Rise up, my fellas." The next thing I know is, like, 18 chat rooms are, like, linked together, and, like, everybody's working in this Occupy Wall Street chant, and, like, holy shit, all right, so let's get to work.
They took your freedom. They tried to take your courage. Now we know you cannot be stopped.
I grew up in a normal family. I'm from Arkansas. I'm a high school dropout. There's nothing particularly special about me. And there's nothing particularly special about any of us. But together we can form a movement. I am the 99%.
Tricked us into going down a one-way street, and then they cuddled us because we were on a one-way street. They were really mean and kind of violent.
Were you wearing your anonymous mask when you got arrested?
I was too.
I don't want to hide my face, but sometimes I feel like I have to.
People are dismissing you guys as anarchists.
Well, I'm an anarchist, and many Anons are anarchists as well, and so are many of the people who support us and work with us.
Anarchy. Thousands of Occupy protesters flooded the streets.
The sinister mask fashioned on Guy Fawkes, the revolutionary who attempted to blow up the British Parliament buildings more than 400 years ago, has become a worldwide symbol of anarchy and revolution.
They are terrorists.
The other side, the rich motherfuckers, portraying us all as destructive, mindless anarchists and so forth, really exposed how reactionary and how inherently violent the police state really is.
I'm a journalist! I am also a protester!
This guy was just arrested, didn't do anything illegal. This guy was just standing around too.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! Stop it!
the Jews fooled the Germans because they got to Germany and they're very like serious, rigid people. And the Germans were like, oh, they're just like us. And so they got this great success in Germany. And then the Germans figured out, oh, they took over our banks and it's hyperinflated our currency. Fuck these people. Right? And perhaps the punishment was disproportionate to the crime. But
maybe.
The Jews were the criminal people in Germany and they did have something coming to them, you know? Just a little.
Perhaps
not the whole Holocaust.
I certainly don't blame you for walking away. It's a good thing you're a troll. You can always pull that kind of troll card.
He's obviously a troll and a by all accounts, an asshole and highly offensive and of dubious moral fiber and dubious moral standing.
He is an internet troll, and for the uninitiated, that's someone who just likes to mess with people for the sake of messing with people.
Trolling is a rhetorical style that exposes somebody else's personality flaws by eliciting a reaction from them that shows the true nature of their character.
He pinpoints your vulnerability and he immediately starts to exploit it, but for a higher cause, to show that you're hypocritical, to show that you have misogyny, to show that you yourself are racist while you're yelling at him for being racist.
Trolling is in the Socratic tradition of questioning everything and driving people nuts until they question their assumptions. And that's basically what a good troll will aspire to do.
If I were to name parties that I think were great trolls, I'd say Giordano Bruno, Zeno of Elea, Jesus Christ, Joseph Smith, Brigham Young. I definitely named some parties who used a very combative style of rhetoric, but probably nobody alive.
You meet Weave in person, and he's the nicest guy in the world. He'll hold the door open for you, he'll grab you a soda if you ask him, and if you meet him online, he'll spew a whole bunch of anti-Semitic crap, and he'll be really mean.
I'd like to think of trolling as a way of expressing working class discontent. I recall recently that Gina Reinhart called the working class people of Australia lazy and without self-control. Trolling is the right of said people to respond by telling her to perhaps stop eating and get on a treadmill.
You say that trolling is about creating something that expresses the true nature of the character. I wonder how what you said about Gina Reinhart exposes the true nature of the character if you're just talking about her weight.
When she has inherited wealth from her father, a bunch of mines, and she runs around calling the people that pull the minerals out of the ground for her a lazy and stupid, and it's disgusting. It's a level of decadence and gluttony that I think speaks not only through her weight, but her general demeanor. She's a loudmouth, obnoxious idiot.
I'm not a bigot, except by the original definition of bigot, in that I air my opinion very loudly without the concern for others' fucking cries of help about, oh, he's saying something that we don't like to hear. That's actually the initial definition of bigot before it was associated with a racist, somebody who loudly airs their opinion. And it says something stark now, that bigot is a pejorative term.
There's a quote from Voltaire. It says, to find out who rules you, find the people you may not criticize. Why do we all have to agree with each other? And that's what freedom is about. It's, I can call you a disgusting kike and we can still live in the fucking same society.
He actually is trying to shove this down everyone's throat. Freedom of speech at all costs, as hardcore as I can make it.
He's a crazy fucker, but, you know, he's our crazy fucker, I think.
What was it, the gay nigger society? Oh crap, I can't say that on camera, can I? I should probably not put that on camera.
The Gay Nigger Association of America has been around, I think, probably since 2000. It is a very old troll organization. I was elected president of it in 2010.
Figured out what words to choose, so it's time to mention Jews.
The name is based on a Danish short film called Gay Niggers from Outer Space.
The gay niggers come from the planet Anus,
They are much, much more intelligent than any other creature in the universe.
When Hurricane Sandy swept through New York, they posted a bunch of pictures on Twitter of black people like looting and stuff from like Sandy Loot Crew is what they called it, the hashtag. Tons of media outlets picked it up. If people were tweeting out pictures of white people in suits stealing TVs, the media would actually investigate it and be like, all right, this is bullshit, instead of just reporting on nonsense without any forethought.
Trolls in trouble. Computer hackers find themselves on the wrong side of the law after breaching AT&T security.
I mean, I guess there's like a blurry line between like Goat Security, was it a troll or was it a hack? But I mean, the name Goat Security invokes that terrible image of that ruined my childhood.
He named his company Goatsy Security. So if you know what Goatsy is, G-O-A-T-S-E, I'm not going to explain it.
Hey, there's a gaping security flaw here.
No, mommy, make it stop.
Goatsy Security, who are these guys? And they're Googling Goatsy, and they're getting the Goatsy picture.
They're called Goatsy Security, is that my pronouncing that correctly?
Yeah, that's right. We're analyzing coverage from Bloomberg, Goatsy, The Register, and Forbes.
Goatsy Security would expose the gaping security holes in your systems.
A corporation like AT&T and Apple, you know, the only way you can really get to them was literally to send it to the media and make a gaping asshole mockery of it.
We're here today to announce that our office has filed criminal charges against Andrew Ornheimer.
Fucking pounce on him, like a fucking. I don't understand it.
The picture that the press has painted of me is unfair, and I'd love to have a discussion, a fair discussion. Truth triumphs in the end.
Would you say you did anything wrong?
I don't believe I've done anything wrong, no.
What happens when a hacktivist comes along? Some kid, right, like Weave comes along and like punctures the invincibility of the United States government, or AT&T. You minimize the power of these institutions by doing that, right? That's why these kids have to be stopped. Come on, everybody. Everybody, we're going.
Can you whistle the Ode to Joy? Knowing you, I hope to see you all again. If not,
write me shit and keep causing trouble. Cause as much trouble as you can in my stead.
That was classic, of course.
We'll talk to you soon, okay?
You're not coming in?
No, I'm coming in. I just don't know how fast they're gonna take you.
In my country, there's a problem, and that problem is the feds. They take everybody's freedom, and they never give it back. I'm going to prison for arithmetic. I added one to a fucking number on a public web server, and I aggregated this data, and I gave it to a fucking journalist at that man's publication. And this is why I am going to prison, is arithmetic. Fuck this country.
America's priorities are our priorities.
We are developing solutions that prevent cyber threats from becoming cyber attacks.
Because at Northrop Grumman, values are what enable us to perform at the very highest levels. Because we know that what we do affects the security of our nation and other nations around the globe.
Northrop Grumman.
CACI.
Lockheed Martin.
Booz Allen Hamilton.
Abraxas.
Palantir.
Stratfor, leader in global intelligence.
A lot of these companies recruit very much from the CIA and from the military intelligence and that kind of thing. That's very, very common for board members in particular to be either ex-generals, ex-CIA, ex-NSA in some cases.
Even people who are paying close attention to it, like me, had never really focused on those players before until Barrett started doing the journalism that he was doing.
There's always been contractors. We had contractors during the American Revolution. Let's be real in terms of history. We've never had what were defined as inherently governmental functions, including the centerpiece functions of the intelligence system, the most secret being turned over for profit to corporations. If you have that kind of control because of the accesses you're granted and the government giving you the deep state intelligence, the deep state data, guess what? You get to serve the state. You get to justify its continued existence. You're going to color the world with the mentality of the state, which is the world's a dangerous place. There's lots of threats out there. It's a target-rich environment.
These are people that are in this to enrich themselves, right? They're people in the government and they're the people in this business. And they don't care that it's not helping anyone. These are not patriots. These are people that maybe have military backgrounds. They might think of themselves as patriots, but they are not patriots.
We can meet and surpass shareholders' expectations.
Branch into adjacent markets and pursue billions of dollars in unconstrained growth opportunities.
They're invested in the security theater. Hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars have been spent on national security. Ostensibly to practice. I can actually say it's actually in the trillions. The total amount of money. I would argue it's the largest redistribution of wealth in the history of the United States.
Wars are not meant to be won, they're meant to be continuous. And if you want to hold a continuous war, whether in real life or on the internet, then you need an enemy that can't be destroyed. And Anonymous is impervious to really being destroyed because it's decentralized, it's everywhere, and it doesn't even have to exist. I mean, they could just say it exists and then it would. And it's sort of just like terrorism. Terrorists are everywhere. Terrorists, your neighbor may be a terrorist. So, you know, we have to remain vigilant, you know, and that's the same thing that's basically happening online.
Right now I've got Barrett Brown,
founder of Project PM
and one of our cyber experts.
Barrett Brown joins us now to break it all down.
So is this an official declaration of war against Booz Allen Hamilton and possibly other contractors?
Yeah, we just got around to declaring that war just now.
I still collaborate with some anonymous participants within my own group, Project PM, acquiring more information and bringing attention to what's called the intelligence contracting industry.
So he has this initiative called Project PM, which is a crowdsourced wiki that is supposed to investigate the mushrooming cybersecurity industrial complex.
It's a collaborative research project.
You're tapping into the collective consciousness of the world, which is always an incredibly powerful thing to do. That is going to be the future model of journalism.
The collusion in part with press, mainstream press, was we're just gonna sort of look the other way. We're not gonna actually use the powers we have available to us.
He was building up this database of who is doing what with who, you know, what intelligence firms are working for what government entities, what outside ones are working together, what contracts have they landed that we don't like, you know, all that type of stuff. Stuff they don't want the public to know about.
There were these hacks going on. We're expecting these data dumps. Shit's about to start getting crazy, if you know what I mean.
Goodbye.
Going through, you know, thousands of emails is kind of a huge undertaking. It's a lot of reading.
Did you do that? Go through hundreds of emails?
Can I say that?
These people were contributing to what they believed was a journalistic project. They were contributing anonymously, they thought, to help the cause of journalism. Obviously, Barrett was onto something. Otherwise, there wouldn't have been this type of reaction.
Forty-one months, 3 years, supervised release, one drug test within 15 days, computer monitoring, mental health evaluation, $73,000 restitution to U.S. Treasury to be given to AT&T. He reached for his phone, he reached for something, they fucking tackled him, handcuffed him, took him out for like 15 minutes, he came back, not just in like handcuffs, but like with the thing around his waist, like the big chain, laughing. Like, and seriously, like walking around the courtroom, just going like, like that. I gave him the thumbs up.
You guys fucking seen this?
How dare you be skillful? How dare you utilize your knowledge?
Fucking absurd.
And of course it's AT&T's fault. They are responsible. How can you say that the company that designed the website is not responsible for their security flaws?
So the federal prosecutor said during Weave's trial that just because he has a special skill, he shouldn't have power over other people. That's how they view it, you know? And it's not incorrect to say that people who understand computers have you know, power. It's just, I don't think the answer is coming down on our prodigies and our geniuses. I'll put it this way. There was a time when you hacked a company and the company hired you. Now it's you hacked a company and they come and they beat the shit out of you.
Hackers, hacktivists in prison by virtue of pointing out weaknesses in the very structures that we depend on as a common good. But we weaken the common good for what? We're turning on ourselves. And any time a country empire turns on itself and begins to find threats from within, well, that should tell you how far gone we are.
Howdy, Internet. My internet blogging must have pissed somebody off. They have cut off my fucking TrueLinks access because, of course, we live in a country with a childishly authoritarian government that can't handle anybody saying anything mean about it on the internet.
I miss you. I really do. There's so many of you that I can't. Hopefully I see you in a couple of years. I wish I could call each and every one of you. I'm still in prison. I've been denied access to both sunlight and food.
I can't tweet via the normal means any longer, but I will still read everybody's responses. It'll be snail mail to me.
Fucking barbarism. Keep up the good fight and you know, make trouble while I'm gone. You guys gotta carry the internet ruin torch, I suppose.
Oh, God. Weave. That was one of his better
communiques.
I was outside grabbing a cab and I get a call from an unavailable number. And it's like, do you want to accept this toll-free call from Andrew from federal prison? And I was like, oh God, it's Weave. I could barely make out what he was saying, but he's like, set up an asterisk box so I can upload things to SoundCloud. I'm just like, okay, like, whatever. We had email access for a month, and then they took it away because they figured out that he was sending messages to another person who was tweeting them out from his account. He and someone else had like code words set up, so if I said like, say this to my mom or something like that, then the next line would be a tweet. They were trying to shut him down, and we found a way to subvert it. ISS, our best client. Scroll a macro, real giant.
Sitting in a chair, getting mad, defiant. I'm the man where they can't spam compliant. The more that they try to, make this go away, the government, it keeps coming back, and it'll bring more attention on Weave. It
took him a couple years to garner 5,000 followers, and then as soon as he goes to jail, in a month, he gets 5,000 more. I got the Tommy Wiseau, director of the room when I spit flow, singing Weave should be chilling and get mo, because a man's afraid of gay names when they raise the crypto. It took them a month to figure out that we were uploading to SoundCloud, even though there was like news articles about it. And just a few days ago, we looked at the caller ID, so we had two mysterious phone calls. One of them was from US government, all capitals, and the other one was from Federal Bureau of Prisons. Ever since then, we haven't heard from them.
Kind of the ashes of Lulzsec, Sabu wants a new thing, a new group, a new cause going forward, and this becomes anti-SAC.
With the visuals of machine guns, this was no longer a laughing matter, and they were not playing games anymore.
He was training people to attack government websites and attack large corporations and businesses.
Pound anti-SAC.
Pound it to the bleachers.
Pound any sec.
If you're sitting below deck in the lows, go salute, bitch, and show some respect.
Pound any sec. Pound
it through your... Greetings, pirates, and welcome to another exciting Fuck FBI Friday release.
For Fuck FBI Friday, we are releasing 1 gigabyte of private emails and documents.
It was asking for trouble. And trouble came in a way that... even, like, nobody could have even written this.
Anti-SEC culminated in Christmas of 2011 with the Stratfor hack.
I remember, like, being with my family around Christmas, like, glued to my computer, like, looking over, trying to interact with my family, right, at the same time as, you know, the Stratfor stuff's going on, and I guess there's that glee that happens, right? The glee that happens whenever, like, oh, this happened, this big hack.
Some people are just hanging out, you know, because it's like, you know, I'm a devotee to train wrecks. And other people are, like, seeking out knowledge. Stratfor is a private intelligence contractor. They act as a outsourced private version of the CIA.
The national security journalist, Joshua Faust, he said that Stratfor is no different than a private investigator, but PIs don't have the sort of clientele that Stratfor had. Hunt Oil, National Oil Well, Varco, Emerson Electric, Dell Computers, Northrop Grumman, Lockheed Martin, Department of Homeland Security, Defense Intelligence Agency, U.S. Marines, and they don't have the sort of informants that Stratfor has. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, Mexican diplomat Fernando de la Mora Salcedo, a DEA pilot and sometimes supervisor William F. Dionne, giving them information off of JWICS, top secret classified computer network. So that's not the PI that you would hire to see if your spouse is cheating on you. That's Stratford.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
The gifts
that Anon Santa left under the Lulzksmas tree are just the beginning.
Cyber thieves made off with the personal details of hundreds of thousands of subscribers.
They woke up to find that they'd given an unexpected Christmas present of $50,000 between them to numerous high-profile charities.
Here comes Santa, here comes Santa.
Expect us.
Here comes Santa Claus. Here comes Santa.
Julian, will you dance with me? It's not about the money.
Money.
We want the world to dance.
To take an ex-FBI agent and use their credit card to make a donation to the Red Cross on Christmas Day, I get that it's criminal, but it's also, it's wonderful in its own way.
The Stratfor hack, it's claimed, also contains email conversations between Stratfor employees and officials in government.
Every week, a company or an agency, is this going to get worse?
I think so.
People broke into something and wow, criminals. Well, okay, even if you want to call them criminals, they're coming up with this information that looks a lot like criminal activity.
The day that WikiLeaks published the global intelligence files, which is what it calls the Stratfor leak, The Atlantic wrote an article titled, "Stratfor is a joke and so is WikiLeaks for taking it seriously." And that was the very day of the leak, so surely they didn't read the 5 million emails that I've spent more than a year researching. The 5 million emails have just been published. The most important revelations are still unknown.
The information involved got to us because several young people sacrificed to get it to us. They went out and took it.
Anonymous hacker Jeremy Hammond, number one on the FBI cybercrime list, pled guilty to Christmas hacking spree.
Jeremy Hammond. Jeremy Hammond.
Jeremy Hammond, qui fait face à lui.
Known as the electronic Robin Hood.
Jeremy Hammond.
Computer hacker Jeremy Hammond has been sentenced to 10 years in prison.
As a former journalist, a former investigative reporter for the New York Times, I am stunned that the rest of my colleagues, well, I mean, frankly, I'm not that stunned, are not here.
Jeremy's going to jail for 10 years. I don't think a lot of people in this country are going to find out about it if the New York Times doesn't cover it. That's just the way that the media is set up right now.
There's a lot of people on the outside supporting him. He's gotten a lot of letters, so, you know.
Hammond's actions are acts of civil disobedience, fundamentally.
In hacking Stratfor, Jeremy Hammond achieved some degree of transparency. It opened our eyes to things that we needed to see.
सच का साथ दिया है और उन्होंने सिर्फ उसी को सामने लेकर आए हैं जो सच था.
25 years after Bhopal, after a gas tank released toxic gas into the city surrounding the factory, they were monitoring dissent and demonstrations against Dow Chemical.
Data wants to be free is the hacker credo. The real questions we need to be asking is, you know, when this data is, you know, shared with people, who is it benefiting and who is it hurting? Jeremy's apartment, you know, is just books scattered about the floor, books on the shelves.
What could be more dangerous than books?
The internet. You know, which is really just one giant book about all of us being written in real time.
To the extent that Jeremy Hammond is responsible for those 5 million emails, he did something entirely necessary.
Stop projecting this.
If the U.S. was a country that was actually governed in accordance with the rule of law, then I would be the first to oppose any crime against any company, including hackers. But the fact of the matter is that this is not a country governed in the rule of law.
We love you!
We love you!
We all love you, Jeremy!
We all love you!
We all love you!
Jeremy, flash your light!
Jeremy!
My name is Parrot Brown, and I've been waiting for this day for about 6 months. In a way, I've been waiting for this day since I was 7 years old. On March 5th, I received communication from a certain individual saying that I was going to be raided the next day at my home.
They go to his house, his apartment, and he had spent the night at his mom's house.
You know, I just go to my mom's house and sleep over there sometimes. We've been very close. Next morning, I woke up at 6:30 by my mom. She's scared. I go downstairs. There's two FBI agents. One is named Robert Smith. He is a FBI cybercrime fellow. They say, okay, we've raided your house, your apartment. Do you have any laptops here you'd like to give us? And I said, no, I don't have any laptops here you'd like to give us.
So they get another warrant for his mother's house and find the laptop. Then they charge his mother with obstruction of justice.
When I was 7 years old, I first heard the term FBI. My parents were fighting a lot. My dad would sometimes get angry and throw things at my mom. And part of the reason for that was because my dad was being indicted by the FBI. I went from living in a nice house in Highland Park, one of the nicest communities in America, to living in a two-bedroom apartment with my mom and grandma and sharing a bed with my mom for the next year when I was in third grade.
They'd gone after his father and bankrupted his father. And his father was eventually found innocent and apologized to by the court. So basically, the FBI ruined his family.
When I was in the backyard, and I remember I heard the Mexican FBI agent bring the other one back in and said, oh yeah, the bad guy's back here. It was that day I realized I'm a bad guy. You know what, I had no idea beforehand, you know? And even now, I still have trouble really sort of internalizing that. But if the FBI says it, it must be true, and from now on, I am a bad guy.
It's kind of like a quad, and everybody in the apartment complex can hear this man ranting against the FBI on the balcony. And I'm getting a little bit concerned, but I also want him to have his, because he, you know, he's very brown. He says crazy stuff. In the evening, we sit in the tiny chat, just joking around.
I'm not wearing a shirt. People like us who aren't totally fat can do that.
Hi, I'm Kurt Maxey.
An on-board guy.
On-board.
Hey, can you tell me if you're a gift or not? She said shit. I swear to God, she said shit the other day. It was crazy. And the picture on her fucking Twitter is the same person. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's a real person.
Oh my God.
Look at your
pretty. You don't have to really think I'm a character. It's like super passionate about this argument.
Oh, is Barrett getting fucking raided by the FBI?
Yes.
Holy shit!
If you're in the place getting raided, okay, you don't know anything because all of a sudden your utilities go out. And the utilities go out because the concern that the concussion grenades might start a fire. So they don't want the gas or electricity running. Okay. And none of the stuff you see on television where, you know, they go at the door with the battering ram. No, that door comes down in one blow. Okay, and you're down on the floor, okay, with one of these macho jerks pointing an assault rifle at your head, swearing at you and telling you to freeze or he's gonna blow your fucking brains out.
The second agent came around in his camo with his gun, and he looked at me as if he didn't know there would be a girl there. Barrett's mother came over, she sees Barrett Brown V, and then the ampersand over and over and over again on Twitter. Barrett Brown banned is a way that people communicate that somebody has been arrested.
He's talking shit. There's no crime against talking shit. But maybe there is now.
Robert Smith's life is over. So when I say his life is over, I don't say I'm gonna go kill him. But I'm gonna ruin his life and look into his fucking kids. How do you like them apples?
What kind of threat ends with how do you like them apples? It's like from like 1840 or something like that. If it was just threatening the agent and that's all he was being charged with, I wouldn't even care about this case. Let him and Special Agent Robert Smith go out back and duke it out, or let Special Agent Smith beat him up, or whatever he has to do.
The second indictment comes, and then it's like a fucking kick in the gut. All these guys are doing are trying to, you know, put the fear in him, trying to pressure him to, you know, flip. Barrett's such a stubborn asshole that he's never going to flip.
Their claim is that he took a link, copied it.
It's journalistically important to get the client list.
Pasted it into the Project PM chat room, and in that one move, produced criminal exposure for himself.
The Barrett Brown case is another one of these seminal cases, and the government wants to send a very chilling message. It's fundamentally a First Amendment case. How dare you hold up the mirror to us?
They called Project PM like a criminal organization. And that's what people freaked out about, because there were a whole bunch of people who hung out on that server or that wiki, and they're like, wait, there's a criminal.
I think they're after who? Anyone else? Any other names to put on our list of people to watch?
The tingly feelings of like paranoia crawling up my spine like a spider, they're there for a reason. Just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they're not after you.
So Jeremy Hammond did the hack, 10 years at this point. Who's the guy that's looking at 105 years at this point? It's Barrett Brown. And what's the difference? He's disseminating the information. He's doing something more dangerous than what Jeremy did.
Here's the message it sends. From the government to the hacktivists who are getting great coverage and are becoming folk heroes through the press. Don't talk to the press because we're going to get their computers and we're going to get their sources and we're going to get you through that. To the press who are covering the hacktivists, don't cover these hacktivists because we're going to get you.
Here's what I want. One, I'm no longer your bitch. Two,
All of my charges are dropped. Three, all of Barrett Brown's charges are dropped.
That's up to the U.S. Attorney.
Figure it out.
Hector Xavier Monsegur is responsible for the arrest of Jeremy Hammond and other Anonymous and LawSec members.
Sources say he began cooperating with the FBI.
I'm the de facto leader of a movement, screaming hack the planet back in 99. Activism in its prime, purple hell had the dot milk.
I felt like my brains had been blown out, like it was the last scene of The Departed.
The FBI arrests Sabu, and they turn him within a day, and they have him back on the internet within 2 days.
This isn't like some guy going undercover in the Gambino crime family, in person for years. None of us had ever met him before. He was just this guy we knew from the internet.
He talks the talk so forcefully with that kind of New York personality. You know, we are doing the right thing for the people. We are building this anew from the ground up. We are taking down the ugly, evil, capitalist, imperial machinery, and we are building it back up with our own hands. My brother, he says.
Looking at Sabu's interactions with reporters during the time that he was an FBI informant, Sabu could have easily just told the reporter, like, no, I don't want to talk to you, go away. But that's not what he did. He engaged in like an hour and a half long conversation and then screen capped it and handed that information over to the FBI. So that's not a free press. The government has journalists under surveillance.
Do you think the government's targeting you?
I hope not. I hope I'm not. Shit.
Everybody's paranoia is just through the fucking roof. Wait a sec. If he was working for the FBI from that moment in June to this moment now, they didn't delete his timeline. They didn't try to hide any of that stuff.
CNN, you want the interview? Send a print message to the nickname Sabu.
Want to speak to me? Want to join the fight? Go to Wall Street and protest.
Sabu and Jeremy were partners in crime. They were the digital Bonnie and Clyde, if you will. Except one of them is working for the FBI the whole time.
The FBI is operating in sort of a new theater, which is online. The government likes to use these hyperbolic terms referring to cyber warfare, cyber weapons.
The feds, by proxy through Sabu, were giving Jeremy the 0 days to get into these websites. In order to, say, entrap a terrorist, they would sell him fake explosives. But instead of giving him fake explosives, the 0 days are real. In the hacker world, you either get in or you don't get in. There's no fake hack. They didn't it wouldn't be a crime if it was a fake hack.
Thank you.
It's the only way I could describe it, dude. She filleted him. The amount of cooperation was truly extraordinary. And it was just amazing. She just kept saying it over and over. It was truly extraordinary, truly extraordinary. And, you know, and I gotta say too, I don't know what I would have done in his position. I really don't. Although, you know, you have to walk a mile in his shoes to understand. There's a lot of people that are gonna be mad though. The amount of truly extraordinary cooperation that he gave.
This was the first time anybody had ever seen him, at least publicly. Like, this was real. This was finally coming to a close. And he was facing the guidelines between 21 and 26 years. He walked out of the Manhattan court complex a free man. Yeah.
He immediately cooperated with the FBI when they arrested him. And the judge said that that was probably the most significant aspect of the case, was that Sabu flipped so quickly, which enabled the FBI to sort of become a part of Anonymous over a 9-month period. They were apparently sitting at the computer with him at times. He had a camera in his apartment or house that was videotaping him every day. He was debriefed regularly by the FBI.
Judge Preska said, and I quote, "I salute you."
The prosecution and the defense and sort of built him up to be this sort of conservative folk hero, like the model FBI informant, the person who every informant should live up to be, to the point where it made it impossible for them to give him jail time. You can't, it would have been bad for the informant program for him to have worked that long, to work 3 years and then be sentenced to prison.
Sabu pretty much neutralized Anonymous.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah.
Neutralized Anonymous.
After he went down, everyone's afraid of following any leader, and they're also afraid of, you know,
C-chat
starting an
general.
Operation on their own.
In general, nobody trusts anyone if you go on any IRC chat. They're all just talking about, you know, like,
who's the Fed?
You're the Fed. You're a Fed.
Yeah, what about the Fed?
Come
on. Yeah, and what about
me?
The
but like, forget
who cares? Even
yeah,
off.
You know you're a Fed. No.
At the end of the day, he's just a hacker getting used by the government.
Sabu is the big snitch. Like, the ninth circle of hell is reserved for Sabu. Him and Cain and, like, Judas will be there with Satan.
Lean back, bitch. We be sending an injection. Magic quotes off, join table intersection. Put it up on base, then it won't get erased. Then 20 million hits to get down like some cavemen.
Been an unfortunate deficit in what people have read and what people have written about an issue that is of extraordinary importance. Trapwire.
Barrett sort of shines the light on this stuff. You say, oh my God, it's actually happening. You've got the emails right there.
He stumbles across this. Stumbles across it, starts talking about it.
Trapwire manages to take lots and lots of data from the closed circuit cameras that are found in large urban areas and makes the information more actionable and functional.
Trapwire is software that can match surveillance data taken from multiple closed circuit cameras from across the country.
Video feeds are fed into a centralized system that
analyzes them for patterns of suspicious behavior.
To understand Trapwire, you have to understand sort of the larger context. Because Trapwire is a critical piece of the surveillance apparatus. This is actually doing very large swath, persistent surveillance.
In 2007, Trapwire cost about $1.7 million to operate in Los Angeles County. What we know about how it functions is largely gleaned from those emails.
Trapwire has been deployed in Seattle, in Los Angeles, in DC. According to a Stratford email, there's like 500 cameras in this New York City subway system equipped with Trapwire.
The New York Times said that Trapwire was only used on 15 cameras in the entire country and that the DHS wrote it off as a failure. That's a complete lie.
We had gone to 30th Street Station to troll Trapwire. And so what troll Trapwire was for us was essentially acting out these things that the security researcher Justin and other people had said this might work to trigger Trapwire's alarms. Sitting there holding my laptop and looking around, and
we
like
were
a little bit.
Tweeting, we did video.
And they were live being ridiculous about the whole thing.
Yeah. Obvious, I mean,
yeah.
We ate with a senior official in the Philadelphia Police Department. During this, the Homeland Security Unit for Philadelphia Police had come to him and said, Dustin Slaughter and Kenneth Lipp are at 30th Street Station, and they're worried that they're going to smash cameras, that we have something terrorist in mind. It blew our minds when we found out. They thought they were monitoring this. They actually were paying attention and freaked out about
they're
it.
They're doing what everyone's worried about. Right. Like, yeah. It's not
anarchists are running all over the place and smashing, burning, looting.
Coverage of Trapwire in the U.S. The whole story was smothered in its crib by the New York Times.
It's an open secret that the mainstream media has special access to the halls of power. There was a phrase I used to hear at NSA. We're going to tell them what we want them to hear, not what they need to know, what we want them to hear. That's pure manipulation. That is PSYOP InfoOp. You're saying from because you can, you're controlling the narrative.
Hail victory!
Go, 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 go.
I was in a hunger strike cell, and they were taking my blood to make sure that, like, I wasn't starving to death, you know? I was on hunger strike because they refused to give me my books and my magazines and my newspapers and my mail. I spent the majority of my time in the shoe. They were like, if you continue, we're gonna force feed you. And I'm like, well, you're gonna force feed me. Hey, I ain't backing down, you know?
The infamous computer hacker known by his alias Weave is a free man after more than a year behind bars. An appeals court has now overturned his conviction.
Every bit of an operation, making copies, so they hating. So I'm keeping my methods close to the chest. I rock the knife on speed dial, case I got a social internal contacts that ain't taking fake mode. Oh no. My aim designed off, checking to see if it's suspended or if it got resetted, appended to the essence. TXT, the enemy is holding all this.
Time behind bars has made Weave even more outspoken than before.
I can't watch my society rot when a bunch of federal scum want to just throw anybody that they disagree with in a prison cell. It's the end of the West right now. Mm-hmm. And we got to fight for it. Somebody has to.
You have no instincts to flee like Edward Snowden or Julian Assange.
I'm not running. This is my country.
This case is at every step of the way, from the
The initial criminal complaint to my time in prison has always been about my speech, and they've wanted to silence me. And they further punished me in prison and subjected me to conditions above and beyond any other of the prisoners at my facility because of my speech. They wanted me to disappear from public view and memory. It was inside the shoe, there's an author, Alexander Solzhenitsyn. He was one of the few authors that kept writing after Stalin told all the authors that they weren't allowed to write any literature that was compelling anymore. He ended up in a prison system called the Gulag. And he describes there the steps that they do to try to break you down. And I kept checking off the bullet points that he listed. He had a 30 bullet point list of all the various interrogatory methods that they used in Soviet Russia. Temperature extremes are one of them, and they'll turn up the AC to freezing temperatures while he was sleeping, and then they'll pump up the heat during the day. So, they come and I couldn't sleep because they would bang on the door every once in a while, and they'll shine the flashlight in your eyes, and keep waking you up at night. They'll put you on a bunk and you can't even sit up, and there's a light like right next to your head, and it's pretty terrible, no doubt about it. It's pretty terrible.
The surveillance state's already here. It's already here. We're constantly on camera. We can't put that back in the box. We can fret about it and say, oh gosh, we need more controls. That infrastructure is there and it's not going away.
They can watch us through our webcams. They can listen through our phones. There's no privacy left, virtually. We are the most watched, surveilled, monitored, eavesdropped population in the history of the human race.
If you have nothing to hide as justification for violating your rights, then you have nothing to worry about. You know where that phrase came from? Goebbels from the Nazi era. Nothing to hide? That means there is no privacy.
I left Iran to come here, and now I can't have security or privacy? All we want is just fucking live our lives. Half of us wouldn't even give a shit if we could all be left alone. It's my right by birth to have privacy.
They want to own you. That's a power relationship, superior inferior.
If I know every single thing about you, about what you think, how you reason, what your fears are, what you're planning, what you're doing, and you know nothing about me because I'm shielding my behavior behind a wall of secrecy, I have incredible power over you. The power imbalance between us is immense because I can now manipulate you, I can threaten you, I can alter your behavior in all sorts of ways, I can anticipate your behavior, I can prevent you from doing things that you're planning, I can prepare in defense of what you're doing, I can always stay many steps ahead of you.
This mentality, this pathological, you have to understand the mindset, you have to understand the psychology behind those who want to know everything. That means anything hidden, anything private, anything sovereign is a direct threat to the surveillance state.
The capacity of this agency to spy on people and to know everything that they do is so extreme and awesome. At any moment, pure totalitarianism could be imposed and the American people would have no place to hide.
Security and surveillance state is put into place in order to keep a population captive, and they now have all the mechanisms to do it. Absolute iron control over a restive population, so should the population become restive.
The United States unchained itself fully from the Constitution. People still don't fully appreciate it. Talk about mass surveillance, all those stuff. No, they've unchained. This is an alien form of government. It's completely anathema to democracy. It's completely anathema. But obviously the government's not gonna come out and say, hey, guess what? We're under national emergency conditions.
I have time they come after someone like myself and the wealth they have, it damages them to the extent these things happen and they get publicized. The population is antagonized. Now, I didn't get into this to stay out of prison. I'm still trying to figure out, you know, how I can be most effective from here.
I'm going to continue hitting large companies and institutional powers. I'm not going to take no shit from nobody. Fuck them if they can't take a joke.
I was not gonna sit still and remain silent, because if I had remained silent, I myself would have been complicit in the conduct of a crime against the sovereignty of who we are as people. That's we the people, capital W and capital P, we the people.
Just sign off.
Right.
Like, you don't have to be a victim of trolling. Like, right. You can just turn off the internet.
System of reality, every avenue of avarice, some mavericks of information. Face up with the candidates and cameras are there to document the struggle live in person. Take a peek behind the curtain. Situations worse than anything the casuals and NPCs can dream of. Trust this team of brilliant bastards. Go on tearing the whole scene. Journalists and media don't buy what they are feeding you. Depleting you the truth because
Sabu got off. Judge Preska and the attorneys and the defenders got on their knees and filleted him.
That's like a lot more sex than I remember going on in the courtroom.
Don't limit your activism to just the mere world of computers. Take it to the streets. We need more foot soldiers in the streets to fuck up shit.
Deep into the void.
Dallas, Texas native Mr. Brown joins other infamous Texans who fought the government, such as the Branch Davidians at Waco, Texas. Fucking really? Really? The Branch Davidians? Really? Fuck you.
With a mic attached. Focus groups began with advertising. Then it got involved within the
motherfucker shouldn't grab a plate. Although it's harder to swallow, I would rather taste the truth. It's for all its food. Pursue effective revolution. There is no need to procrastinate.
I just wanna lie in. I just wanna lie in.
We just wanna ride in.
Tear gas in the air.
Police state here.
Nah,